Finally, performance and project management, which Veronica's outlined and shared with children. Turning over the page to a proposed budget cut savings, a reduction in early health services, including children's centre rationalisation from 5 to 1. Currently, we run 5 children's centres, which are much valued by parents, especially in terms of peak support that they receive. There is no way that we can keep 5 functions. What we can reasonably expect to do is to move 1 and 2. Into this building to share costs and just keep some provision going. Reaching youth offending services, as I said earlier, and ceasing early support functions, but more on that to follow. Questions were asked about that this afternoon, but we're still in discussion with the NHS as to how that would be. We've been asked Andy now to do his bit, and then we'll do the Q&As on the 3 presentations you've heard so far.
Hello, my name is Andrew Scott and I've got the Cabinet Portfolio for Health and Partnerships. And tonight I'm going to talk firstly about public health and explain what that is. And secondly, I'm going to talk about the voluntary sector and how that's going to be impacted by our proposals. And finally, I'm going to talk about some of the facts that we are proposing to do, which I think are important to set out. So on the first slide, you'll see that list of things that we are calling off. And to put that call off in context, if we take that off now, spending this year, it would be around about £6.7 million. By the end of 2020, we want to reduce that to £5.3 million. So we're going to make significant savings within that offer, but still deliver those services. And that'll be saving £2.9 million over 4 years. If I just leave sports development team for now and move on to the sexual health services, people might not realise that there are a number of services, clinical services, which the council now have to pick up the cost. And in fact, public health didn't actually become the council's responsibility until about 2013. So it's fairly new to us. But with sexual health services, and any clinical outreach, treatment, and testing, and things like that, the council have to pick up. And that's the cost of currently of about £950,000. The big cost to the public health is the North 19 service. And that's healthcare workers, healthcare people coming out to visit mums with newborn babies. And tracking people's progress if requires them from there to 19th needed. And that's a big cost, that's £2.1 million. The third one is substance misuse. The council has a statutory duty to deal with drug and alcohol misuse. So they have to provide treatment programs for substance and alcohol misuse, legal exchanges, and supervised consumption. And that's going to cost us about £1.3 million. We have a stop smoking service. It's going to be a reduced service to what we're offering now. We are going to focus primarily on pregnant women because evidence shows that in Darlington in particular, there's still a high level of smoking amongst pregnant women. So there's still some work to do, and we're not going to ignore that. And also manual workers. So there's a high prevalence of smoking amongst manual workers, and that's going to cost us only £47,000. Public health advice is going to come in-house, but it's still going to cost us £459,000, and that is a statutory service. The council relies on public health professionals to advise them in certain circumstances. Health checks. If you go to your GP and you have a health check, the likelihood is the council picks up the cost of that. The GP surgery will charge the council for that, in one respect. And prescribing and pharmacology. Anything. If you've got your GP, you prescribed alcohol, nicotine, weight management things. Again, the council will pick that up, and that's £520,000 in cost. So a lot of people don't realise that public health covers all these things. If I move on to the next slide, and just talk about the reduction in specialist advice. So we're going to look at local public health specialist public health team. The DAT team, drug and alcohol services, we are going to, while we're still offering treatment services, the DAT team is the specialist management service who deals with all that. And we're actually going to reduce that so we're not going to have a specialist management team. That is a significant risk to us. I'm incredibly concerned about that. It makes that we may not be able to respond effectively to emerging priorities and changing trends in drug taking. So that's a concern. And we won't have a dedicated community service team. Well, that will be replaced by the youth offending team. But as we heard Bill just say, that's going to get reduced as well. So there is a significant reduction in what we're going to offer. We're going to re-procure services. And as I talked about with things like sexual health and stopping smoking, we thought up till now that it was good practice that we invested in preventive services. So we've tried to prevent people from getting those prescriptions, from getting those treatments. And I'm afraid that's not called business anymore, and we're going to have to withdraw quite heavily from those areas. Health Watch will just simply move to the statutory minimum, which is Health Watch will be funded at 60 pence per population. So what we're going to cease, well, it greatly saddens me to say that we are going to cease the Healthy Darlington and the Hope Darlington. The Healthy Darlington is a really colourful bit in front of the Dolphin Centre if you walk to the main entrance. It's only been going a couple of years. It's provided a great service in terms of offering something to people who just want a bit of assistance in getting fitter, in getting a bit more healthier, better eating, stopping smoking, things like that. Unfortunately, it costs £438,000 over the next 4 years. I think simply it's not part of the core office. It saddens me to say that we will be withdrawing from that. And I have to pay tribute to the team, the staff in the health hub, who have made a huge success in a very short space of time. I'm also really dismayed to say that we're proposing to withdraw our funding for the Arts on Prescription at the Bridge, which is a mental health service we offer people, which I know is hugely valued, and sadly we can't do it. Specialist drug and alcohol support as well. We fund some of the voluntary sector organisations to provide very specialist drug and alcohol support to homelessness services, and again there'll be a withdrawal of that service. So we're going to remodel community safety, we're going to remodel the specialist health team, and we're going to remodel the drug and alcohol commission in partnership over the lifetime of the MTFP. I'd like to just talk about something called the social fund. Again, the council's only had for a matter of a few years, previously administered by the Department of Education. I mean, look, it's not on the council, so. But I think it's important just to raise, because it's not statutory. The social fund is sometimes called crisis loan, so people who are on benefits and they're in real crisis can access a loan. These people, as DJ will be paying for that, they now come to the council for that. When the government gave us the responsibility for that, they gave us just short of £500,000 for that. We're now proposing to only spend £170,000 on that. That's a significant cut of people, should be aware that some of the most vulnerable people in our society have less to access. But on the good side, we've done some really good work with King's Church and Frey to be able to offer service. And we know this area is increasing demand because food banks are used more than ever before. So these people use food banks as same people who are likely to have crisis loans. And I just want to talk about the voluntary sector. The voluntary sector will be affected by the cuts. At the moment, we're looking at around about £250,000 cut across all of the voluntary sector. There'll be more than that if some of the voluntary sectors are provided a particular contracted service. And that if that contract service is also being cut. So it's around about £250. And they're organisations like HUK, CAB, DAD, First Stop, Groundwork. But there's actually 100 organisations that get some sort of funding. The vast majority are very small amounts. And to mitigate that, I want to talk about some add-backs that we're proposing. So firstly, we're proposing an add-back of £50,000 for financial and debt advice. We think that's really important. We know that every pound spent on financial and debt advice, you probably get four or five or whatever it is back. So you get real good value for money. It's a withdrawal from what is being provided now, but there's £50,000 there every year for that. Secondly, we want to add back £50,000 for community development and engagement. And that's for helping, that's to build on some of the successes that we've had with things like good friends and colleagues and cares and a better care for us, but also looking for some of the smaller organisations as well. And we're also looking at one-off funding, so we can't maintain this funding, so this is a one-off fund, and we're saying we want to give £100,000 into a voluntary sector development fund. So we know the voluntary sector is going to be adversely affected. We want to give £100,000 to be able to work some of the work with the initiatives and hopefully help that way. And also we see huge opportunities. We've got some great organisations in this town. The Council for One, DfE, Cummins, EE, and there's a few others, but they all allow their staff volunteering days or volunteering times. We start to access some of that, but it's dropping the ocean over activity. We do a lot more with that. So building on the future, we just want to draw that resource and make use of it in the communities. And for that, we've got a £50,000 one-off sort of sum to be able to do that. And we also want to work with an organisation called the County Durham Community Foundation, which is a charitable organisation which gives grants to small to medium-term-sized organisations. And we've put aside £20,000 of one-off to be able to work with them and match fund some of that. So we can actually be looking to bring more money into Dalit. Cheers.
We've stopped there with those three sections to take any of the questions. Yeah, gentlemen, can you give us a look at where you're at? Can you speak more brackets there? No,
it's only a point about the overall meeting. Can the delegates please go to the microphones near themselves, please?
Yes,
because I'm not making a difficult to understand what you're saying.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Can we just get a card of
the question? As you're aware, the council field and safeguarding children by Ofsted, what additional money has been put aside to ensure that the next Ofsted review
and
ensure that we get a good report?
The Ofsted in the Children's Services. We're currently working with an organisation called Quadrant on an improvement plan which we will submit later. Resources have had to be moved back into Children's Services because realistically we did take too much out of that in the previous budget. That's a matter of public record. That money has gone back in, and I believe that we're making good progress. Is that answer?
Mr. Harker mentioned earlier on in his presentation about the non-services argument, responsibility. One of those was school crossing patrols and the cost involved in them. Many years ago, the motor trade used to put a levy across all dealers in Darlington to provide training for apprentices. So why doesn't the council put a levy against schools or go into partnership with schools so that they actually fund crossing patrols a bit, cost away from the council?
Regrettably, it's nothing to do with it. Whether it works or not, I actually don't think it will. I'm old enough to remember in previous weeks some people came to remind me that I started serving my time under the old levy system where employers were levied and you actually had proper training councils. It looks very much as if local authorities do have nothing whatsoever to do with schools, but it is vitally important going forward that we keep some kind of having probably a tighter grip on things like skills. But everybody keeps going on about we're facing a skills shortage. Nobody seems to be doing an awful lot about it. Now, that may come up in the Christian brief about the combined authority and seeking more control over how our colleges function, because at present, I think too many of our colleges compete with each other when they should actually be complementing each other. It's yet to be decided what we get in that devolution deal. Is that fun? Sorry, if you don't use the mic, I can't hear, I'm definitely not
here. It didn't really answer, because my question was, why don't you form a partnership with people like schools to provide funding for really services which are part of their remit, you know, safety of school children. They have a responsibility to look after the safety of school children at school and going to school, I would suggest. So why on earth don't you form some sort of partnership where they will aim with the these sorts of patrols, and even also spread that across all the other services? Why don't we form partnerships with people like me, with companies, with people like this, rather than subsidising roundabouts? Why don't we stick something more tangible into the community to provide services that make a difference to the community?
In terms of partnerships, we do have extremely strong partnerships with our schools, and they are picking up a huge chunk of the local school transport budget that the council used to have to carry, which we no longer can. They do all they could do with the school crossing patrols and other things. But in terms of partnerships with large companies, I think as Andy said, we've got partnership deals with EE, with Cummins, with all of the big bodies, and they all dedicate time to volunteering. And that time, Chris might want to come on to this in his presentation, that time is incredibly valuable in terms of the support it gives to various organisations across the whole of the borough. I suspect most people don't realise how much volunteering goes on in this town, and it is truly a phenomenal amount. It's twice the national average. You know, people in Darlington are incredibly good at volunteering, for example, even the EE scheme, the Cummins scheme, street champions, people, the wildlife refuges, but a myriad of volunteers, not just in the kind of social services sector.
Hello, good evening. I'd just like the Cabinet to clarify, please, about the nature of the government grant, the 1.8 million that's going to be spent on renovating two gypsy encampments. First of all, why do you think it's necessary, and could that grant not have been used towards the library, or is it particularly ring-fenced towards, I don't know, small minority groups, or however it's... I don't know why it's sort of spent on the gypsy encampment. I think that money could be spent on the library. However, I'd like to know the nature of the bid, or the nature of the grant. Is it just specified for gypsies or travelling community? My second question is, could the council, the cabinet, please justify this 60-year PFI contract that it has with the indoor bowling club in Morrison's? Because it seems an enormous waste of money. I think it's over £25,000 a year that the council have agreed to pay whether or not the bowling club's closed. And again, surely that money would be better off spent on keeping the bridge open or keeping the library open at Cockerton or even better Crown Street. It just seems to me the council are wasting lots of money. When you talk to people anecdotally in the street, people generally feel that the council is putting money on things which aren't prioritised. For example, the head of steam. Surely that money would be better off going to the libraries, when I think the footfall in the head of steam must be minimal compared to the library. So I don't feel you're really responding to genuine needs of what the average person in the street of Darlington feels.
Travel sites, the authority has a legal obligation based on the number of travellers within its boundaries to make provision. We then get a grant from government, which we applied for with the support of the travelling community, and we were actually very successful, and therefore it's not cost us a penny. So no, it can't be used for any other purpose. It's like an awful lot of grants the authority gets, and I understand why the public get confused that suddenly they see the council doing something which they don't think is necessarily a hard priority. But the top the bottom of it is, a specific grant can only be spent on that specific project. If you spend it on anything else, well, you just can't spend it on anything else, because they only pay you either at the end of the job or halfway through, whatever. So it's any other way that would actually be called investment. In terms of Morrison's, I totally disagree. I'm really saddened by the Northern Echo reporting it. The reality is that for £25,000 a year, in six of the figures we mentioned there, the membership of the Bowls Club is 300 people, most of whom are elderly, a lot of whom are lonely, and find that a very, very good service. And I, for one, think it's actually value for money that we get there. Yes, we're tied into a long contract, but don't forget, that was built, and I heard no voices raised against it 20 odd years ago when it was built. People were just pleased that we got a Morrison supermarket
and we got an indoor bowls club. People were very happy with it then, but it still provides exceptionally good value for money.
Okay, what I want to say is surely it's not normal to have a PFI contract for 60 it's not years. PFI. 60 years, that's what the Northern Empire said. Are you saying that's wrong?
It's not PFI.
Sorry? Okay, it's not PFI, so okay, even worse. So why is it tied in for 60 years then? Even if the bowling club closes. I don't know how you can justify that.
It was a contract the council entered into at the time the supermarket was built to make a social provision which people thought would be beneficial.
But why for 60 years? It's not logical.
You need to ask the person who's signed that. I think it's a million where we are now. But to counter the argument, I still think it's value for money.
Well, I think the general feeling in this room is that it isn't. And I think we
can hear them. The lady there, the guy was in. So it was a little bit out there, but yeah.
I would like to ask, when you mentioned reducing the speed the country repays its debt, that's one thing. There is a lot of debt, and it seems like a lot of people are suffering because of the debt, and a lot of money has been wasted by the council, like those the marketplace where we have that water, and that cost a huge amount of money, and a lot of people didn't want that. We've lost a lot of historical features. And with the closing of the library and the property and the mobile library, there was a lot of people who worked hard and petitioned. Children in the Cockerton area, I belong to Cockerton, and I was part of that school, and that was a major service, still will be. And there was a reduced service there, and now they want to relax that. The market, this is an historic town, and a lot of people are proud to live in Darlington. And it just seems like we're losing more and more of the historical thing, you know, and we don't want that to go. And the children's services, vulnerable adults, lots. We're here, the suicide rates are increasing in Darlington. And with all these cuts and everything, sure starts alone. Yes, you can say instead of 5, it's going to be 1. There's lots of people who couldn't get to that 1, and they'd just be isolated. So I can tell you, I feel for one, the depression, isolation, lots of things are just going to get higher, and it's just going to be such a mess. So basically, until people are more aware of these situations, I think basically the town's just going to, it's just going to be like a landslide, really.
Can I just say a few words about specifically about the debt, because I think lots of people
are like,
it's virtually my mouth. I think there's a lot of misinformation, to some extent in the echo of misreporting about the debt, and I think generally misunderstanding about what debt means and why we have it. So the debt that we currently have is £151 million. £71 million of that debt is actually in a separate account. We have a housing revenue account which looks after all the council housing that we have. The money that goes into that, the income for that, comes from council tax, so from council residents paying rent for their houses that they rent off the council, and grants that come from government specifically for council housing. That account is ring-fenced, it's self-sustaining by it, so the government grants and for the rents that council tenants pay. It has a debt, and that debt is funded entirely by that account. So, of that 151, it leaves £80 million of debt that this local authority has in its other general revenue fund. The things that is used for is the capital scheme. So, the figures I've shown at the beginning is the revenue budget, the money that we spend every year providing service on a day-to-day basis. Capital schemes, one of the things that we do where we need a lump of money that we do not have sitting in a bank account. So, for example, when we built the office block behind the town hall to retain staff in the town centre, that required capital funding that we do not have sitting around in the bank account, so we borrow money, and in that particular instance, the scheme is then funded in the long term by the people using it, paying us rent over a long period of time. So yes, there's a debt, but the debt is serviced in that particular instance by the people who then use the offices over a long period of time.
Of that £80 million, I think, off the top of my head, when we took out those loans, about £54 million of those loans were effectively being financed by the government. So what would happen is, we would say, we want to do X, or they're telling us you need to do this scheme. They would give us a capital sum of money, we would do the scheme, and then over a period of time, we would then have to pay back that debt. And what we were doing at the time was, they were then saying, well, actually, here's the revenue to fund the debt. So, in those schemes, we weren't actually doing anything other than managing the finance of getting a capital, we see, at the beginning, and then paying off the debt, the money that they were then giving us to do. So a very small proportion of the debt that we have is actually debt that we took out, knowing at the start that we would have to pay off. And when those decisions are made, we have rules about what we can borrow based on what we can afford to pay back in terms of debt repayments. And one of the things that has happened, in that £80 million that is in the general fund as debt, the part of it that the government previously had been giving us money to pay off the debt repayments, they stopped doing. So we suddenly have a debt that when we went into it, our understanding was that government was going to fund it for however many years if that debt was outstanding, and they stopped paying it. But the real issue, or the real point where they get across, is that people saying we've got lots of debt, if you didn't have the debt, we wouldn't be in the mess we are. It's just completely wrong, it's missing the point. Firstly, all the authorities have to, when they do capital schemes, they need to have borrowing to pay for those schemes, because they do not have large sums of money that they can use for one-off schemes. And secondly, the money that I was talking about, the revenue budget, which is being cut, is entirely separate from that capital debt. A small element of it, I'll come back to it in my presentation, a small element of our revenue budget funds the debt that we have to pay off, and it is a very small percentage, but I'll come back onto that.